Learn the process of the Buddha. Next slide, please. Very short presentation. I thank my guru, my parents, my teachers, my patients, and my audience. Next, please. Ptosis is abnormally low position of the upper eyelid as compared to both the eyelids. One person's upper eyelid position may not be the same as the other person's upper eyelid position. It always has to be compared between both the eyes, and the palpebral measure, the fissure, has to be measured. Significant ptosis presents with superior visual field loss. Some compensatory mechanisms may be seen as the patient walks into your office. The head may be held high, chin may be up, or eyebrow may be pushed up. Next, please. This is a cross section of the upper eyelid. On top, you see the frontalis muscle. Then going on, you see the dorsal plate, the levator aponeurosis. I will mention a little bit about the muscles as we go through. Next, please. The muscles of the upper eyelid, I have mentioned four muscles. Levator palpebrae superioris, innervated by the third cranial nerve, originates from the lesser wing of sphenoid, traverses the orbit, becomes a fibrous aponeurosis, and then inserts into the tarsal plate. Upper eyelid skin crease is formed by the attachments. Next is a mullus muscle, which is a smooth muscle, has sympathetic control, and this is what is affected in Horner's syndrome, causing myoptosis. Frontalis, supplied by the seventh cranial nerve, lifts the brows. I have included orbicularis oculi here because it's not directly linked with ptosis, but it is the muscle which is used to blink or while sleeping. That also is innervated by the seventh cranial nerve. Next, please. Causes and classification go together on this slide. Congenital causes of ptosis include failure of neuronal migration within the levator muscle complex. So instead of aponeurosis, there is adipose tissue and fibrosis. Aponeurotic type, that is involutional in elderly, or after ocular surgery, where there is dehiscence of this levator aponeurosis. In younger patients, it is seen often with the use of hard contact lens, that is recurrent trauma inside the upper eyelid, surgery, trauma, and infection. A neurogenic type, which is an innervational defect as seen in third nerve palsy, Horner's syndrome, and Marcus Gunn jaw breaking. Here in Marcus Gunn, there is a cross innervation between the fifth nerve and the third nerve. And consequently, whenever the patient opens the jaw and closes the jaw, there is a winking scene. A myogenic type, which is more often due to dystrophy and ophthalmoplegias. A mechanical type, where there is an overhanging mass or edema. And a pseudoptosis, which is a mimic actually because of enophthalmos or facial palsy, or because of a contralateral proptosis. Next, please. Just an illustrative case, I saw this patient about a week or two ago. Patient had an injury, fell on his face. You can see the contusion on the right side, surrounding the eye. And he got discharged, he was okay. But he came back with the ptosis. That is, when the contusion healed, we could see all these things. The pupil, if you see, is normal on both sides. Only the lid is overhanging. Next, please. The history starts with onset duration, whether there is any variability during morning or evening, what is the severity, whether it is unilateral or bilateral, is there any associated condition, precipitating condition, family history. Some of the measurements that are used in these are the margin reflex distance, which is above and below. That is, from the central corneal reflex to the upper eyelid margin is usually 4 or 4.5 millimeters. And the sum of these two is the palpebral fissure measurement, which is usually 7 to 11 millimeters. Levator function, which is seen as an eyelid excursion when the patient looks up, looks down, followed by upgaze. And in infants, if you divert the upper eyelid as the child looks down, spontaneously the lid will become normal, where if the function is all right. Margin crease distance can also be measured. Next. The yellow line shows the upper margin to reflex distance, the red line is the palpebral fissure, and the dotted line is the skin crease. Next. Some of the signs that are associated with this: head posture, turning of face, chin up, frontalis action. Palpating the orbital rim and eyelids may reveal some mass or edema or bone problem. Canthus for infections, nasal bridge for collapse, eyelids, proptosis, strabismus and lagophthalmos as seen in children. Bell's phenomenon, not a Bell's palsy, Bell's phenomenon. This is a palpebral oculodyric reflex. On attempting to close one eye, that is the affected eye, the eyeball moves up and out. This is seen in bilateral facial palsy associated with Guillain-Barré syndrome. Lid retraction in the other eye, lid position in downward gaze, extraocular movements as in strabismus, visual problems in children, pupils for Ornos third nerve palsy, especially if the patient has undergone an anterior cervical discectomy where the sympathetic chain may have been involved in the retractor causing Ornos palsy. Fogel's lid twitch, that is in myasthenia, the patient is asked to look down and then up. The eye goes into an upward saccade. The upward eyelid shoots up and then falls down because it becomes rapidly weak. That is called as Fogel's lid twitch. Herring's law. This law states that there is equal innervation of the reciprocal eye muscle in each eye. Therefore, manual elevation of the more tortic eyelid decreases the muscle strength to keep the eyelid elevated. Therefore, there is a relaxation of the contralateral eye and that closes in that eye. Next, please. So, this is slide. I pulled this flowchart from the American Association of Neurology website to see how to assess for a ptosis, patient with ptosis in the outpatient department. Mainly, this flowchart concerns whether there is a levator dehiscence or disinsertion as seen in elderly, whether there is a Horner's syndrome, if it is bilateral, whether it is a muscular dystrophy, myasthenia gravis, or a likely third nerve palsy. Next, please. Some of the tests which can be done to assess the ptosis: fatigue test as in myopathies, ice test for in myasthenia, ice cubes are placed over the eyelid, which leads to, surprisingly, recovery of the levator muscle. Tensilon test, where hydroponin injection improves lid function. Phenylephrine test, Schirmer's test to evaluate the tear function, and corneal sensitivity test. Next, please. Proper evaluation necessary for the correct management, because as you can see, wide number of causes and wide number of etiologies are there. Several procedures are available, mostly done by plastic surgeons after evaluation by neurologist and the ophthalmologist. This includes excision of the upper part of the tarsus so that the lid margin becomes smaller, resection of the Müller's muscle, which is supposed to help 1 to 1.5 millimeters of lid opening, levator advancement, etc. Neurosurgeons have almost no role except if the it is an aneurysm causing third nerve palsy. Next. But there is a joy in diagnosis, therefore my interest in this subject. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.